Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Spells, Wishes, and Quests by Martha Carr and Michael Anderle. Narrated by EJ Lavery. Chapter 1.
All right, let's try another one.
Charlotte Weaver stood in the center of the apartment's living room, one hand outstretched toward the coffee table in front of her. The other was slightly higher, fingers loosely wrapped around her wand. With a twitch of her nose and her lips quirked to the side in concentration, she focused her energy on what magic she could feel inside Detective Alex Taylor's apartment, which wasn't much.
Here we go.
She flicked her wand at the full water bottle she'd placed on the coffee table and launched a simple spell at the object, which should have been an easy target. A smile bloomed on Charlotte's lips when the water bottle wobbled on the table.
Come on, she prompted under her breath.
Then the bottle stopped moving, and at the same moment, a shriek rose from the kitchen. Loud pops and clunks followed, joined by a low whine. Then something snapped, and the faucet popped out of the sink and whizzed toward her across the room.
Crap!
The fairy godmother ducked a second before the faucet would have hit her in the face. It thumped into the wall behind her instead. Then, spray and the hiss of something that shouldn't have been there filled the apartment.
Oh, no, no, no!
Charlotte leapt to her feet, bounded around the coffee table, and sprinted toward the small kitchenette in the far corner of Alex's apartment. The sink spewed water from the pipes all over the kitchen counter and the laminate floors.
Seriously?
She spun toward the drawer of dish rags beside the regular-sized fridge. Charlotte whipped several rags out of it and placed them all over the sink, even trying to stuff a few into the pipes to get the spray to stop. A chuckle rose from the other side of the living room, where Sir Thomas was curled up in the corner of the couch. The talking cat, who wore shiny black boots and a wide-brimmed hat with a feather stuck to the side and walked upright, watched Charlotte's panicked attempt to clean up, eyes glistening with amusement.
Perhaps you should attempt that spell with an empty water bottle.
An empty water bottle?
Charlotte looked up at him, still pressing the rags down with both hands.
That would barely weigh anything.
That is the point,
Sir Thomas replied with a sly smile.
And if you put in less effort to move something lighter, that same effort might not be so easy to project onto something else.
I didn't project my magic onto the sink, she grumbled. I was focusing on the water bottle. If I can't even move a piece of plastic with a simple levitation spell,
she sighed heavily and slumped.
Well, I don't see how I'm going to improve my magic when even the simplest spells go haywire.
The conversation had taken her focus off her efforts to stifle the spewing pipe, and it sprayed into her face. Charlotte backed away, sputtering and shouting as she raised both hands to block the spray. When that didn't work, she stepped back until her hips bumped against the opposite counter, and the sink simply kept exploding with an endless supply of city water.
This isn't getting us anywhere.
Lying on the other side of the coffee table, in front of the couch, the enormous black dog who had been a cat until Charlotte appeared in Cincinnati chuffed. Sir Thomas interpreted, his tail twitching over the edge of the couch.
Cat and I would help you if this wasn't such a watery situation.
I appreciate the sentiment, she replied, from both of you.
Then she stepped forward, whipped her wand off the kitchen counter, and aimed it at the fountain in the sink. In this world, spells rarely did what they were supposed to do. Her magic was far more likely to follow the general theme she wanted. Working that way left things open to interpretation, but it was easier to get a mostly successful result. Magic acted much differently in this world than in her home and ever after. Notably, it didn't work the way she was accustomed to, and there was far less of it. However, there was always a way to accomplish what she wanted, or close to it. The light of her spell formed a plug shape as it spiraled into the pipes and the interior plumbing connected to them. A few seconds later, the water was a much gentler stream, then a trickle, then disappeared. A grumbling gurgle rose from the pipes that ran through the building. Then clangs and clanks and thumps before the apartment fell silent.
"That did not sound good," Sir Thomas said, trying to get up from the couch.
"How do you know?" Charlotte quipped, unable to take her eyes off the sink. "You've never fixed a broken sink."
"Neither have you, I'd wager."
Cat lifted his head, let out a low growl, and thumped the floor with his tail twice.
"Maybe the commentary should be reserved for those willing to assist with mishaps around the apartment," Charlotte quipped. "Since neither of you falls into that category, keep your mouths shut so I can figure this out."
Cat opened his mouth to reveal his large, sharp teeth. He let out a sigh and a high-pitched squeal, smacking his lips noisily when it was over. Sir Thomas shot the former feline a sidelong glance and chuckled again.
"You know what I mean," Charlotte added, a smile flickering at the corner of her mouth as she approached the no longer spewing kitchen sink.
She peered down into the pipes, tilted her head, and shrugged.
"It looks good to me."
"I'm sure Alex will be pleased with the improvements you've made to his home," Sir Thomas stated.
Charlotte perked up and grinned at him.
"You really think so?"
"They're likely to baffle him," Sir Thomas added. "He might not even know what to say."
Raising her eyebrows, the fairy godmother considered the implications of that statement. Her smile grew and faded as she tried to maintain control of her facial features and emotions. The idea of Alex being impressed by anything she did, even though he'd told her as much several times, still made her stomach flutter.
Now was not the time to get caught up in fantasies. About a human from Cincinnati, no less. Alex was wonderful. No one could deny that. He had been helpful to Charlotte and Cat and Sir Thomas of necessity, and they had accomplished an incredible amount together. The most important thing was finding and reuniting the pages of her fairy godmother handbook, so she and the other ever-afterins, who did not belong in Cincinnati, the place of banishment for fairy tale creatures, could go home again. Then she would discover why people like she, Sir Thomas, and innocent ever-afterins like Bo Peep were being sucked through those interworld portals. She reminded herself of her duty to Ever After and the Fairy Godmother's Guild, and the mission she had taken on since there were no other fairy godmothers in Cincinnati. She cleared her throat, nodded at Sir Thomas, and tried to pretend the talking cat hadn't sparked a daydream that was, for all intents and purposes, unlikely to come true. "It's nice to be reminded that one is appreciated when we have a lot more work to do than fixing busted pipes. I really need to focus on figuring out how to get a handle on what magic I can use in this world, instead of worrying about water bottles."
Sir Thomas crossed his legs and gave a playful sigh.
"Something like a feather, perhaps."
Charlotte clicked her tongue at him.
"Someone's very tongue-in-cheek today."
"Apologies. The idea of your magic combined with water has put me in a combative mood this morning. I am sure Cat would tell you the same thing."
Cat lifted his head and chuffed again.
"You know what I think?"
Charlotte brandished her wand at the pair across the living room, then folded her arms.
"I think we need to get out a little more."
The loud bang of a bedroom door down the hall cut her off. Charlotte, Sir Thomas, and Cat all turned that way. The detective barreled into the living room without raising his dark glower from the floor. Sir Thomas broke the silence.
"Detective," he called. "You look terrible."
At the unexpected remark, Alex abruptly stopped and looked at his magical guests. He blinked multiple times, then remembered why there was a talking cat and a dog who used to be a cat and a fairy godmother in his apartment with him.
"Had a rough night."
He gave a curt nod, then continued across the living room toward the small table by the apartment's front door.
Rough night, eh?
Sir Thomas engaged in a languid stretch.
I remember those well.
When I was a kitten, I was terrified of lightning. Any time a thunderstorm rolled through the valley where I grew up, I didn't sleep a wink. It probably didn't help that herds of lightning eaters lived just next door to the empty log I called home at the time. If you've never heard that many lightning eaters in one place during a storm, the ruckus is unlike anything you have ever known.
Thanks for the pep talk, Sir Thomas,
Alex interrupted.
I'll make sure to stay away from lightning eaters, but that's not what kept me up last night.
You didn't sleep? Charlotte asked. Alex paused and looked over his shoulder at her.
I slept, just not very well. It's fine. It happens.
There have been a lot of changes for you in the last few weeks.
I'm not the only one.
He rifled through the stack of mail on the table, then rummaged through the wooden bowl in which he kept spare change and his keys. Frowning, he moved the bowl to the other side of the table and bent to search beneath it, then went to the coat closet by the front door.
Has anybody seen my keys?
Charlotte pointed at the table.
They normally go in that bowl.
Yeah, they do. Unfortunately, they're not there now, which makes me wonder if anyone's gone through my things. Actually, many things make me wonder that. Not that I'm blaming anyone, but I have to ask. Has anybody been messing with my stuff?
Sir Thomas glanced at Kat, who sprawled on the area rug beneath the coffee table.
Define messing with.
Charlotte couldn't help but snort. Alex eyed Kat with dismay, then shook his head.
I doubt my keys went missing because he licked them.
Sir Thomas continued to stare at the dog.
I beg to differ.
Or my new bottle of shampoo,
Alex continued as he shut the closet door and turned to the kitchen. Or the clean towels.
Or the boxer shorts I know were in my drawer last night.
Oh,
Charlotte exclaimed, clapping her hands.
Another thing our worlds have in common. Do you box?
Alex stared at her, then shook his head.
No, not that kind of boxing. The point is, a bunch of my stuff has been misplaced, except I don't misplace things. The only difference I can think of is...
His voice trailed off, and he turned in a slow circle as he looked around.
Is that you three have been here? Not that I am blaming any of you. That's not what I'm saying. I just like being able to find things where they're supposed to go.
I'll help you find your keys, Alex,
Charlotte cut in, setting a reassuring hand on the kitchen counter and leaning forward as she nodded at the detective.
I'm sure they're around here somewhere.
Only then did she remember that the kitchen was soaked. She glanced at the counter, then took her hand off, whipped it behind her back, and tried to dry it on the back of her purple dress.
I appreciate that, Alex sighed. Again, I don't think it was you, I just...
You need consistency when so much of your world has been turned upside down.
Charlotte nodded in understanding.
So many things don't make sense anymore. It's perfectly normal, nothing to be ashamed of.
The detective looked her in the eye, and a smile flickered on his lips.
That from a fairy godmother who was sucked through a portal from her world for no conceivable reason and can't use her magic because the pages of her handbook are scattered all over the city.
Charlotte raised a finger.
Hopefully, only the city. That would make things much easier.
Exactly.
Putting his hands on his hips, Alex surveyed the apartment with a frown.
Same thing goes for personal belongings. And keys.
Very well,
Sir Thomas huffed as he slowly rose.
Message received, loud and clear. Your keys are the most important part of your morning.
The feline stretched his forepaws, then hopped off the couch. He copied Alex's posture by putting his front paws on his hips and nodding.
Time to scour our surroundings. Pip, pip.
As Sir Thomas strutted around the living room, The rapier, strapped at his hip, waggled behind him like a dog's tail. Charlotte and Alex glanced at each other and almost laughed. Then Alex noticed the puddles of water on the kitchen counter and the floor, and his eyebrows drew together.
What happened?
There?
Charlotte asked, pointing at the water as if just seeing it for the first time.
I'll clean it up. Don't worry about it. I managed to fix the problem.
Alex raised an eyebrow.
What problem?
A minor mishap with a spell I was practicing.
She broke the sink,
Sir Thomas clarified, pointing at it.
Broke is a strong word, Charlotte replied with a chuckle. More like I attempted a few modifications.
She clasped her hands together, giving Alex a grin that felt too sugary for the circumstances. Cat trotted up to Alex's side and let out a muffled woof that made the detective look down. With a frown, he pulled a bit of shiny metal out from between the dog's jaws and held it up.
Modifications. Including removing the hardware, huh?
Charlotte giggled and waved her hand.
That was an unintended side effect. As you can see, the issue is no more. I fixed it even with the low concentration of magic in your apartment, which, I have to say, isn't enough for me to brush up on my spells and enchantments. It would likely be far more beneficial for all of us if I practiced somewhere else, like where the ley lines are in this world, for instance.
And that's because...
Alex looked at the fairy godmother and Sir Thomas, who was searching under the furniture and beneath random objects for the detective's car keys.
Because she's far less likely to break things when magic does what she tells it to,
Sir Thomas explained. Charlotte scoffed.
I haven't broken anything.
Mm-hmm,
he said with the ghost of a smile. Alex stepped into the kitchen, ran his fingers through the puddle the countertop had become, then peered into the sink, which was filled with sopping dish rags. He then looked into the pipe the same way Charlotte had moments before. When he reached for the cold water control handle, Charlotte grabbed his arm.
No, don't! I'm not sure if...
The squeak of the handle turning made her stop, followed by heavy clinks and metallic thumps from deep within the building, coming up the pipe to which the faucet had been attached. A dribble of water emerged from the hole, but that was it.
Look at that!
Charlotte casually backed away from Alex and the sink.
Just like I said, fixed. No more kitchen fountain. You're welcome.
Alex stared at the sink, then set the faucet beside the handles to be addressed later, and pressed his lips together.
I feel very lucky now that I took a shower this morning.
Why?
The entire building's water supply is cut off, if I'm guessing correctly.
Charlotte gaped at him.
The entire building?
I could be exaggerating, he shrugged. That happens sometimes. I will also admit that this detective is not a plumber, so what do I know?
Quite a bit more than I do,
Charlotte muttered, staring at the sink while Alex took up the search for his car keys.
At this point, that isn't a surprise.
Chapter 2. With a flush rising in her cheeks, Charlotte paced. Then, since it was the only thing she could think of to do that didn't make her embarrassment obvious, she leapt across the kitchenette and snatched up the cookie jar she'd been delighted to see when she first entered Alex's apartment. The lid clinked as she pulled it off. She imagined how much better she would feel with a chocolate chip cookie, and she reached into the jar. Its cold contents jingled.
What?
Charlotte pulled out a set of keys and swung them in front of her.
Alex, are these the keys you're looking for?
He spun, then sighed in relief.
Yes, thank you. I couldn't think of what could have happened to them. Where'd you find them?
Charlotte tilted the ceramic jar toward him with a frown.
The cookie jar, believe it or not, which is devoid of actual cookies.
The cookie jar, he repeated. That's a new one. Thank you. A lot. I'm going to be late anyway, but that saved me a lot of time. I never would have thought to look there.
Think nothing of it, she said to him, brushing the whole thing off. You know how it is. Different worlds, different perspectives.
Different hiding places.
When Alex extended his palm toward her, she dropped the keys into it and flashed him a smile. He returned it and held her gaze before turning around and heading for the door.
I really do have to get going.
Of course, yes, absolutely, she said, brushing her hands off before returning the lid to the cookie jar and the empty jar to the counter. Duty calls, for both of us.
Tell me about it, he added. I'm assuming the three of you have a plan for today.
Yes. Charlotte folded her arms and leaned against the counter, trying to look more casual than she felt. Seeing as your current detective work has zero magical connections, I think Sir Thomas, Kat, and I will focus our energies on looking for the pages from my handbook. Alex smiled.
That's a good idea.
Thank you very much.
Totally.
Alex studied her a moment longer, then frowned and tilted his head.
You're not going to ask Humpty Dumpty to help again, are you?
Charlotte scoffed and rolled her eyes. Please. He got his hands on one page. They're scattered again, and I doubt he'd be lucky enough to find another one.
For the sake of intelligent discourse, Sir Thomas said, lifting a finger in the air, one might argue that Humpty Dumpty is incredibly lucky. Luckier than most. He got his hands on one page of your handbook, and all things considered, that's more than anyone could have expected.
How do you mean? Charlotte asked. The cat spread his arms.
Because he used to be an egg.
A magical egg, though, Alex clarified. I'm not sure that has anything to do with what we're...
A sharp woof from Cat interrupted him, and Sir Thomas turned to the dog and offered a bow.
Thank you, Cat. I appreciate your support. Bottom line, Charlotte cut in to change the topic, since talking about Humpty Dumpty and his magical pleasure den in the swing house still gave her the creeps. We're not going to see Humpty Dumpty. I'm going to try my locating spell again using the map I told you about, and we'll see what happens. I think it's time we focus on what we can control right now, which is trying to find those pages. The sooner we do that, the sooner I have a viable source of magic I can use to get us home eventually. Not to mention, find the person responsible for sending ever-afterins who were not banished here.
I agree, Alex said. Good idea. I look forward to hearing about what the three of you find today when I come back from the station this evening. Hopefully it's not too long a day, but you never know.
I look forward to hearing how work goes for you as well, Charlotte said with a smile, then realized it was a silly thing to say. Alex offered her another nod, then smiled at everyone and headed for the door.
Good luck. Oh, and Charlotte, just a reminder. If you need me for anything today or any other day we're not actively working on this stuff together, you can always call me. The only number on that burner phone I got you is mine, so just dial and I'll pick up. Do you remember?
I remember how to dial a saved phone number. Thank you very much, Detective.
Great. Good. Then that's it, I guess.
Alex turned in one more circle and realized there was nothing else he needed, then turned back to Charlotte and opened his mouth as if he meant to say something else. They stared at each other, his mouth open with no sound coming out. Charlotte didn't smile in case what he said was not what she wanted to hear. Alex sighed, closed his mouth, and nodded again.
I'll see you all tonight, then. Stay safe. Don't do anything I would tell you to reconsider.
An excellent way to determine our course,
Sir Thomas quipped. Alex wrinkled his nose.
I'm going to stop saying that. All right, I'll see you later.
He opened the front door, stepped into the hallway, and paused to meet Charlotte's gaze one final time. Smiling, she lifted a hand and wiggled her fingers in farewell. Alex blinked and cleared his throat, then pulled the door shut and locked it with his keys before heading off through the apartment to get his black 68 Chevy Camaro, which was parked outside. Charlotte gazed at the closed front door, wondering if she had made a fool of herself by being so cheery,
and maybe seeming naive in the face of everything she and her companion still had yet to accomplish. Sir Thomas's chuckle pulled her out of her complicated line of thinking. The feline wagged a hairy, stubby finger at her.
The number of things left unspoken between you two is remarkable.
I hardly think what is or isn't said between Alex and me is any of your business, she retorted. Cat sat on his haunches and whined as he gazed at the fairy godmother with puppy dog eyes.
You are absolutely right, Sir Thomas told the dog with a nod. It is our business when we are in the room, when all those things are left unsaid. Free show for Cat and me.
Then maybe I should start charging admission. Sir Thomas rolled his eyes, then clicked his tongue.
She doesn't have to make an enormous deal out of it.
Come on, Sir Thomas, she said, stepping around the counter and grabbing her purple cape off the back of an armchair. We're going to look for those pages, and the outlook for the day is going to take a turn for the better. Just watch.
Closely,
Sir Thomas replied, as he followed her across the living room. I won't take my eyes off you for a moment. Charlotte forced herself not to sigh, since determination and hope and optimism were vital to the success of this kind of mission. She meant to retain those qualities until she returned to Ever After, having accomplished what she'd set out to do.
Let's get this done.
She pulled her wand out and stepped into the center of the living room.
We're about to go hunting.
It might have seemed like a terrible idea for Charlotte to cast any more spells inside Alex's apartment, but it was a process of trial and error, elimination, and figuring out where her limits lay so she could adapt as the circumstances called for it. Fortunately, pulling up the magical map that served as an enchanted GPS, the one she had used when she landed in Cincinnati, was not a use of magic in a matter of life and death. Also, there were few map spells that had negative side effects, in stark contrast to a levitation spell on a bottle of water that removed the faucet. The locating spell was easy and rather personal, which was why Charlotte had successfully conjured it when she arrived. Charlotte had assumed that the blinking dots signified not one destination, but countless. So her magic was misfiring, and she needed to conscript the help of local law enforcement to bring her magic back to its former strength and precision. After everything she'd learned in the last several weeks of living in this world, she had come to a different conclusion. Now, she believed those dozens of dots indicated the locations of pages from her fairy godmother's handbook. It hadn't occurred to her the first day, since how could an indestructible handbook be in dozens of different places at the same time? It was simply a matter of having scattered its pages across the city. Charlotte still hadn't figured out who or what was powerful enough to damage a fairy godmother's handbook, but she would find out. She had yet to set a goal she had not met. When she performed the locating spell in the living room, she was overjoyed when the map appeared. She was also surprised by how elated she was. For a long time, Charlotte had been charged with protecting the physical safety and well-being of the denizens of Ever After, and she loved her job. At home, she'd also taken her magic and its capabilities for granted. After 2 weeks without her power, she took pleasure and pride in the smallest of magical successes. This was one of them.
A lovely sight, Sir Thomas said, his large eyes reflecting the floating golden map. What is it?
A map of Cincinnati, Charlotte replied with a confident nod. It looks similar to the electronic maps I've seen on Alex's contraptions. You know, the ones you showed me the other day that are bigger than a phone, but
a tablet, the feline offered.
No, she pointed at him.
A laptop? That's the one.
Charlotte snapped her fingers. I have spent much time studying the layout of the city, seeing as I knew we would be exploring on our own at some point. That's a normal thing to expect. I mean, come on. How much time can we spend together? It's, you know, perfectly natural. Everyone needs their space. He has to go to work.
We have our mission to focus on.
Our mission,
Sir Thomas repeated, tilting his head.
Not yours.
No, Charlotte replied. I assumed you and Kat would work with me.
Relax,
Sir Thomas grinned at her, then offered her a low bow, complete with a flourish of his paws and one leg out in front of him.
We are at your service for however long you require us.
Kat let out a sharp bark. Sir Thomas looked up coyly and added,
Kat wholeheartedly agrees.
Well, thank you both very much. I appreciate that. I need help on my quest because there are far too many of us in Cincinnati who don't deserve banishment. I won't stop until I find the who and the why and the where and figure out how to fix it.
Excellent.
Sir Thomas straightened, then nodded at the map.
That is supposed to help us accomplish that how?
With a chuckle, Charlotte pointed at the largest pulsing dot, which was currently near the center of the map.
We're going to follow the blinking lights. Simple, really. This big one right here in the middle, that's us.
Kat snorted.
You're telling me,
Sir Thomas added.
I look nothing like that.
The smaller dots, Charlotte continued, moving her finger around the map, represent what I hope are pages of my handbook. We will follow those, hunt them down, as it were, and scour the area for the pages or the magic involved in scattering them.
Hope?
The feline wrinkled his nose.
You sound more confident than that word expresses.
Charlotte shot him a smirk. That's because I am, good sir. I've spent quite a bit of time thinking about this and assessing our options, and I've tested this locating spell. That much of my magic works, and this is the only explanation that makes any sense. Plus, it's the only option we have at the moment. So yes, I'm more confident than just hope, but it would make me look foolish if I said that and ended up being wrong.
Sir Thomas nodded. Quite the blow to one's ego.
Not that I haven't been wrong before, but everything we do in this world is different from anything we've done in the past. The people are different, the land is different, and the magic is different. We have to come at this from a new perspective.
Agreed.
Sir Thomas put his paws on his hips and shot Kat an exasperated look.
As long as that new perspective does not include me riding pony-sized canines who were once closely related.
I won't make you ride Cat, Charlotte promised. So, let's take a look. She pointed at the closest smaller dot, then traced a path from it to Alex's apartment. Sir Thomas wrinkled his nose.
Fantastic. Why are we going with that one?
Because it's the closest. He studied the map, looking more confused than usual, then smacked his lips and puffed out his chest.
Excellent. Makes perfect sense. I am prepared to follow your lead.
He gestured at the apartment's front door, and Charlotte had to hold back a laugh. She held out the sides of her purple gown and offered him a shallow curtsy in response.
I thank you kindly, Sir Thomas. And Kat, of course.
Kat's tongue lolled in a crooked canine grin. All right. She waved her wand at the map, and the golden lines swirled together before disappearing. She pocketed her wand and took a deep breath.
I suppose it's now or never.
Later, Sir Thomas said. That's the third option, now, never, or later.
I can't argue that, Charlotte said, as they headed toward the door.
I merely wanted to be certain that you were aware of all your options. I couldn't be more grateful.
Charlotte fumbled with the lock, then pulled the door open and waited for her furry companions to join her in the hallway. After she closed the door, Charlotte drew her wand again, looked up and down the hallway, which was free of other people, and tapped the doorknob 3 times. Orange sparks flowed from the keyhole, and metal twisted and shrieked.
Ah.
Charlotte?
Sir Thomas asked. Charlotte wrinkled her nose.
I know I can get this one right. It's a simple locking spell.
I recommend considering the use of a key.
She stared at him and Kat.
What key?
The spare key.
Clicking his tongue, Sir Thomas stooped to the welcome mat, lifted one corner, and groped beneath it. When he withdrew his hand, he extended a...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.